Churchill once said, "War, which used to be cruel and magnificent, has become cruel and squalid."
We are not as we were in 1945. The Russia of today is not the Russia of Stalin. The Cold War has transformed the moral landscape of our lives. The past quarter century has seen vast and rapid changes in the world. The velocity of history is bewildering. Vietnam has confused our memory of the Cold War. Were we the doves in defense, or were we the hawks? Two opposed ideas that dominated the plans for the post-war world: universalism and spheres of interest. Universalism supposed that all nations had a common interest in world affairs. This was Woodrow Wilson's ideal. The guarantee for each nation's security would be an international security organization, the United Nations. Spheres of interest meant that each great power had its own area of special interest to be respected by the other great powers. The guarantee would be the balance of power.
American losses in the war amounted to 500,000 military dead, 22 million Russian soldiers, civilians and children died in the war. Russian borders have no natural defenses. Russia is a history of invasion, from the Tsars to a revolution, to a dictator, to a massacre. Life was always perilous. They had to recover from war. They had to assure their future security. They thought the best way to do this was to dominate Eastern Europe, to control the countries which might otherwise become once again the corridors of invasion. Revolutionaries in their homeland, the Russians in world affairs wanted to restore the old order. Spheres of interest, balance of power. But the Universalists rejected balance of power as too unstable. It could lead to another war.
It would prevent the establishment of an effective world security organization. It was bad for the world economy. Isolation breeds tariffs. It was against the principles for which we had gone to war. The Atlantic Charter, the Four Freedoms, the Declaration of the United Nations. It would cause problems in our domestic politics. After all, 6 million Poles would be voting in the presidential election. And it might tempt the Russians to go too far. Eastern Europe might become a springboard for the invasion of the West. George Kennan of the American Embassy in Moscow didn't agree. He saw inherent limits in Russia's capacity to expand. He felt it would need moral and material collaboration from the West to do so. But his counsel was generally ignored.
Stalin was for his own sphere of interest, the borderlands around his country. Roosevelt was a universalist, possessed by a vision of world order.
My friends, I still believe in ideals.
Churchill, seeking regional groupings within a world system, was poised between the two. Aging, burdened, weary men. Monarchist, democrat, dictator. Two aristocrats and a peasant. Extraordinary personalities. Extraordinary responsibility. England had the tradition of an empire. America had broken away from England. Bolshevik Russia was 24 years old. Churchill grew up with toy soldiers, rich language, and kings. Roosevelt in turn of the century America. Stalin was the son of a Georgian peasant. Churchill went proudly off to adventure in the empire's small wars and an early fame. Roosevelt followed his patrician education by public service. Stalin went to a theological seminary and was kicked out for reading Marx. He joined Lenin. Churchill into the House of Commons, Roosevelt into Wilson's cabinet, Stalin into revolution. Lenin complained of his methods. Churchill drank. Roosevelt became crippled. Stalin, a killer, withered arm. Churchill and Roosevelt could act with flair and the craft of statesmen. Stalin, with the ruthlessness of tyrants. Churchill had his kings and his honor. Roosevelt a New Deal, a strong grip on the national will. Stalin, 5-year plans. Churchill, empiricist, practical man. Roosevelt, supreme politician and idealist. Stalin, power and the blood of his comrades. Churchill is recalled from a decade of retirement to his post as Lord of the Admiralty. 2 days later, England with France declare war against Hitler to protect Poland. A question of honor. 2 weeks later, Russia enters eastern Poland. 10 days later, Warsaw surrenders. In a secret pact, Poland is partitioned by Germany and Russia. Russia's most vulnerable border, bloodied by centuries of invasion, is shut safe by treaty, at least for now. 1 month later, Russia invades Finland. March, Hitler invades Denmark and Norway. A month after that, Holland, Belgium, Luxembourg. In England, Chamberlain resigns. The king makes Churchill prime minister. Hitler invades France. Mussolini joins Hitler. The Nazis enter Paris. At the end of June, Romania gives Bessarabia and northern Bukonia to Russia. More borders. Molotov then demands from Hitler, Finland, Romania, Bulgaria, bases in the Dardanelles.
Freedom of speech, freedom to worship, freedom from want, freedom from fear.
Roosevelt saw a Nazi victory as a threat to the United States.
We shall send you, in ever-increasing numbers, ships, planes, tanks, guns. That is our purpose and our pledge.
In June, Hitler attacks Russia. Suddenly, England and Russia are allies. Dedicated anti-communist Churchill begins the symbiosis with the private remark, "If Hitler invaded hell, I would give the devil at least a recommendation in the House of Commons." In August, he meets Roosevelt at sea to define ideals and consider the aims of the war.
Oh, something like this. The Atlantic Charter, which Roosevelt and Churchill signed on a ship off Newfoundland in August 1941, envisaged a world based on the right of all peoples to choose the form of government under which they would live. It rejected the idea of territorial changes by force and provided for full collaboration and equal access in economic and commercial matters.
Stalin offers Churchill a sphere of influence deal. He will support English bases in Western Europe in return for Finland, Eastern Poland, and Bessarabia. This was not just a communist move. It was the old Russian dream of border control. Back to the Tsars. Churchill rejects this as contrary to the Atlantic Charter. The United States was in the war. Churchill is delighted. "We have won," he says. "The symbiosis is complete."
Well, now Stalin wasn't Stalin when he told the Beast of Berlin that he never rest contented till he had driven him from the land. So he called the Yanks in English and proceeded to extinguish the Fuhrer and his vermin. This is how it all began.
New Year's Day, the United Nations Declaration, the flower of universalism. In April, Churchill warns Roosevelt, "The Atlantic Charter ought not be construed so as to deny Russia the frontier she had when Germany attacked her. Hull is against this. It is not a universalist way to think. It is the wrong deal." May in London, another treaty. Russia and England, 20 years. Italy surrenders. England and America handle the capitulation, keeping Russia out of it. Stalin complains, but Roosevelt has no intention of sharing Italy with Russia. He suggests the Russians send an officer to Eisenhower's headquarters. Universalism at work. In October, Cordell Hull visits Moscow to confer with Eden and Molotov. America, Russia, Britain, and China proclaim united action for the organization and maintenance of peace and security. Stalin said, "A declaration I regard as algebra, but an agreement as practical arithmetic." The Georgian prefers arithmetic to algebra. But Molotov says Russia has no desire to divide Europe into spheres of influence. And Hull returns triumphant.
"While the procedure of cooperation with other nations likewise intent upon security, we can and will remain masters of our own fate."
That December, the three leaders meet in Tehran. It is the high point of their collaboration. The symbiosis seems to work. Churchill asks Stalin of his territorial interests. He replies, "There is no need at the present time to speak about Soviet desires, but when the time comes, we will speak." February, Hull cables Ambassador Harriman in Moscow that Russia is shirking on the universalist deal. Churchill, shifting his balance, suggests that after the impending liberation of the Balkans, Russia run things in Romania and Britain in Greece on a 3-month trial. Hull is not in Washington. Roosevelt agrees. Hull returns and objects. Churchill drops the idea for the moment. George Kennan defines Russia's expansiveness as the ancient insecurity of a location easily penetrated by hostile neighbors. This urge is a permanent feature of Russian psychology. June 5th, Stalin privately remarks, "The English find nothing sweeter than to trick their allies." And Churchill is the kind who, if you don't watch him, will slip a kopeck out of your pocket. Yes, a kopeck out of your pocket. Roosevelt is not like that. He dips in his hand only for bigger coins. June 6th, D-Day, military turning point. 2 months later in Warsaw, the Polish underground rises up against Hitler. Coincidentally, the Russian invasion stops at the edge of Warsaw, letting the Poles do their work for them. For 63 days, a brutal massacre. The Nazis destroyed any alternative to a Russian solution in Poland and weakened themselves in the process. Chess move. At the same time, at Dumbarton Oaks, the three nations agree on an international universalist organization. Another treaty. September. Bulgarian envoys meet in Cairo to surrender to England and America. Bulgaria is close to Russian borders. Russia promptly invades Bulgaria, strong arms the surrender negotiations. After all, we did it to them in Italy. England and America are permitted no role in Bulgarian armistice. Harriman senses flaws in communication. They are not reading our signals. He suggests we humor them, remain firm to our ideals, and treat each territorial move step by step.
Well, here we are. Here we are again. You know, I am actually 4 years older. Which...
Roosevelt is campaigning for re-election and allows Churchill to represent him in Moscow. Harry Hopkins intervenes. Roosevelt then cables Harriman he expects to retain complete freedom after this conference is over. Churchill and Stalin make a deal. Romania is 90% Russian, 10% English. Bulgaria is 80% Russian, 20% English. Yugoslavia, 50-50. Hungary, 50-50. Greece, 10% Russian, 90% English. Only immediate wartime arrangements, says Churchill. An agreement, not a declaration, muses Stalin. Arithmetic, not algebra. In Greece, the communist resistance revolts. Churchill crushes the insurrection, protecting his 90%. Surprisingly, Stalin does not complain. A deal is a deal. Both England and the United States are horrified by Churchill's move. We disassociate ourselves from the venture. George Kennan is fully aware that Russia thinks only of spheres of influence, that their borders are the prime motive. He says they would in kind reserve moral judgment on any like move we would make in the Caribbean, for instance. January, Molotov formally requests 6 billion credit for post-war reconstruction as a favor to the United States to prevent a post-war depression. Roosevelt dodges this. Wait until I talk with Stalin. John Foster Dulles bemoans the shifts within universalism. At Yalta in February, Stalin agrees to free elections in Poland.
The war was still going on. He needed our help in the West. The phrase, in the opinion of the three governments, seemed to imply a Soviet veto. And universalist algebra was Stalin's arithmetic.
Churchill tells Stalin that Poland is a question of honor for England, not for Stalin. It is one of life and death. Throughout history, Poland has been the corridor for attack on Russia. Stalin asks Roosevelt for $10 billion for German reparations. Roosevelt hedges. It will be used as a basis for discussion.
I think the Crimea Conference was a successful effort by the three leading nations to find a common ground of peace. It spells, it ought to spell, the end of the system of unilateral action. the exclusive alliances, the spheres of influence, the balances of power, and all the other expedients that have been tried for centuries and have always failed.
For about 15 years, the 125 million people of the United States and the 160 million people of Russia have had no means of direct and practical communication with each other.
We request a Russian envoy to the UN conference in San Francisco. Stalin refuses to let Molotov come. In April, the French communist Jacques Duclos attacks American Communist Party leader Earl Browder for favoring harmony with U.S. capitalism. Browder is replaced by William Z. Foster, and the party regains its revolutionary identity. Have handled Stalin was gone. Germany surrenders. The Russians try to delay the announcement from France. They want to announce it from Berlin, giving them a propaganda edge, but the news leaks out. Novice President Truman suspends Lend-Lease. If this was designed as pressure on the Russians to soften them up, then it was a fundamental mistake.
Stalin, though urbane at the meetings, was subject to paranoia. He saw the Lend-Lease cancellation as blackmail, the argument over $10 billion reparations for Germany as pro-Germanism, and later the mislaid loan request as sabotage.
Churchill, worried about election returns, was ineffective with Stalin. Harry Truman had a secret weapon, but Stalin shrugs. Machinery of suspicion, counter-suspicion, action, and counter-action had begun. The proposal is inexplicably mislaid during a transfer of records. The Russians find this hard to believe. We must clearly recognize that the Soviet program is the establishment of totalitarianism, ending personal liberty and democracy as we know and respect it.
Despite the pledges of Yalta, the Soviet Union proceeded to consolidate its control over Eastern Europe, arresting non-communist political leaders, suppressing non-communist newspapers, banning non-communist meetings, and systematically eliminating all opposition to communist one-party rule.
Each side believed future stability depended on its own conception of world order. Each side felt compelled to policies the other regarded as a threat to the peace. As each side pursued its own principles, it only confirmed the other in the fear of aggression. Each side felt compelled to take defensive measures. The Cold War had begun. Stalin speaks out against us in Moscow.
From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia. All these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere.
1 year later, the Truman Doctrine gives 400 million to aid Greece and Turkey in the fight against communism. In June, new Secretary of State Marshall announces a 12 billion plan for reconstruction of Europe. July, the Paris Marshall Plan Conference. Molotov and 89 technicians invited to the conference receive a signal from the Kremlin and walk out. But started as a collaboration born of practical necessity through a conflict of ideas and misunderstandings, disintegrated into a war of oversimplified absolutes. The specter of messianic communism was met by our own inflated moral superiority. Good versus evil. Ideological hysteria.